to stand and pledge to the flag, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, tonight's meeting is a committee of the whole meeting, so what that means is that the audience can participate in any discussions as we have going on with the report. And if there's anyone in the audience that would like to come up to the microphone now, if they have any agenda items for future consideration, now would be the time to speak up for those.
Families in the district, either our children, we care about our children. How do we know, Dr. Bibb, how do we know that this gentleman did not engage any of the kids in there? In your letter to the families, you never stated what, if any parents, you could have stated, if any parents talked to your children, if anybody was engaged by their children, please come to us and we'll help you. That's about caring about children. It was not in there. Never. He also states he has limited contact with the local community.
Okay, Quinn.
Yes?
We got your point.
I never got a response. When am I going to get a response? When are the families that are interested going to get a response to these questions?
We can't talk about that right now, but thank you for your comment.
I'm not done. Do I have 5 minutes, I believe?
Yeah, you got 30 seconds left.
The issue that Nancy's trying to say is that because it relates to personnel matter and potential future litigation, these are items that, number one, weren't cited for discussion, even as a public commentary. It wouldn't be prudent for us to allow one individual to make comment without allowing another person notice that they have made a comment about them here. It's just, it's a legal
thing. This is an email sent to the whole community, so I don't know what you mean. I'll repeat myself.
Typically, a school district doesn't want to get into a lawsuit, so when a personnel matter comes to the front, I'm not going to address how you wanted to get something on the agenda or not, but I'm just saying, if a public person were to come up, whether it be anyone in the audience, come up and talk about Joe X, and just start speaking about things, without having given Joe X the opportunity to come here to defend himself, to reach the school district with his potential litigation. It's not a good idea. Then you go to
this one. I don't know.
Right. So, all I'm trying to relay to you is legal strategies of school districts in part as part of the laws of the state of Wisconsin. So that if a person comes up and says, I'm asking an individual to tell me.
I didn't have that thing, but.
So that's the matter of interpretation, and the president has the floor, so.
So Quinn, please sit down.
Well, can you please address us then?
No, I cannot. Please sit down.
I.
Quinn, sit down.
I hear what you say. But families deserve a right, the families deserve here.
We've heard you now, please sit down.
Please do it though.
Any other comments? Items for future agendas? All right, then we'll move along to reports. 3A, strategic plan update, student rigor. Mr. Brzezowski.
How are you?
Good.
Excellent. That's powerful, you know. This will be short. The main reason I wanted to come here tonight, was to introduce the group that worked on this. So if you remember, if you're here, you want to just come forward. Rachel Bouchon is not able to join us tonight. She's focusing on doing some papers and some presentations, so we can't really can't cite her for that. Susan Noah, her mother, is an alum, as well as the president of the site council here at the high school, and is active there. Mrs. Callender, WHS guidance counselor, wasn't able to join us. Natalie Dickens sat on the initial group on the public policy forum. Juanita Fernandez is right here. Student who joins us from, actually, her father as well, Pablo, from Florida. So they're new to us this year, so they brought a lot of interesting perspectives to the table. Everything from what snow is like to the way school should be. John Hushick, who has had a number of students come through the district, is also a teacher and a parent. Lenny McQuiston, district learning coordinator, who's over there. And Don Schwartz, who has so many titles and positions around the community, and so it's amazing that we could actually get him out to our meetings. So I just wanted to take the time to at least acknowledge and give you the opportunity to acknowledge their work. Because what we put forth earlier to you and is included in your packets, I won't go through the details. But this group is the group that came together and we talked about college and career readiness and what that looks like and being committed to that. And those goals 2, 3, and 4 were what drove our last meeting. Really trying to put our heads around the action plan. So as you can see, the detailed action plan are included in the board package. You can see the step by step pieces to that goal. A lot of it will require community input, student input, parent input, and focus groups, and a lot of it will volunteer for that. And I just wanted to take the time to just thank you for giving us that opportunity. And then, it's a great idea, so we're looking forward to that.
Thank you.
Any questions for?
So Tony, will there be like a follow-up periodically with the group, or?
The follow-up, well, what we have is the action plan, just like we do with our plans. And everybody in the group kind of has their expertise, that's why we're there.
Okay.
So, Don has done a great job of bringing up a lot of the community connections and talking about internships. So we look at opportunities at school. Obviously, we have a student head that came around and also about student squad and talked about coming up with some type of system of college career and education tracking, similar to LinkedIn or Facebook, where a little more student and parent friendly, a little more user friendly, so teacher and that, and obviously Susan has been contributing quite often in the leadership of the high school, but also as a teacher, with younger students who have been around as well. So everybody in the group kind of had their take on things and has kind of committed to, in some way, shape, or form, participating in the facilitating focus groups or connections with the community.
Great.
Tony, I see that most of the parents or students are from the high school. Did we offer this to middle school or elementary parents or students?
We did, yep. We put it out to kind of the market and said, anybody out there with parents or students? So that's where
we did it.
The other thing was that we are focusing on college and career readiness. We took the end in mind, started with the end in mind. And the end in mind was looking at parents and students who said, so far I haven't experienced this. ideas and the focus group and the action plan, now that we've got the frame built, now we're going to the truth. So what would it look like in second grade, what would it look like in third, what would it look like in fifth grade, and so on.
Thank you for your time.
Just a side comment, because this is a lot of work, and for all of you that have looked at the rubrics that have been attached, you can see how involved this has been and how detailed the reporting has been so far. So thank you for the quantity and quality of work that went into this. I will say that I'm looking forward to a follow-up. It appears that most of the goals that have a deadline are June and July for the next chunk. Does that seem to be a decent timeline? June and July, so I'm looking forward to the report after that, particularly the grading evidence for design, CCS, CCRS, line scope and sequence by department and grade level, where that should be completed curriculum map, including grading evidence. That one I'm looking forward to see how that map testing is informing the alignment and how well that's going. So that's just a personal note that I'm looking forward to. Anyone else? Questions or comments? All right, thank you. Thanks. Thank you. Thank you very much. All right, 3B, we have community engagement presentation.
That'll be Luann and myself.
Okay.
Mostly Luann. Before she gets started, the reason for this presentation is including us in one of the basic goals that have been identified by the board. And early in the year, we have planned for the development of a strong community engagement process. You had heard, we were starting the process. She wanted to work with us. People feel quite excited to experience that with the school association.
keep going on and listening, from that data, we're going to create a full-own community agreement. The work that I just saw this team doing is a perfect example of that, and would fit beautifully, I'm sure, into what we're already, what we're probably going to hear is something about housing here already, and go out and listen. So I see that as a natural way of actually even expanding with the goals that are coming out of the strategic plan, making more connections for our people to themselves. So that's what this is about, to create this whole strategic plan. And really continuing with what we've already started, is having these teams with community members on them. So I just see it as an expansion of what you're doing and a way to do it in an ongoing way. We can create action teams, we'll integrate action teams, integrate the work into what's already going on in the district. And then we would track progress and hold ourselves accountable. When I say we, it isn't something that we're putting on the students. We really want the community to benefit from this. And that's why people like Don Sports and Rob, Doug, and the mayor of Greenville, that's why we're getting a lot of those people to be at the table up front, to see themselves as leaders of this. So we want to track progress on them, maybe even an annual basis, where we look at the strategic plan in the community, and the community is involved in looking at these on a more regular basis. So that's what it is. So I just want you to know that up front. It's a listening that turns into some money. And from that, we hope that it creates a little more voice in our community for our schools. That both, and that people make more a stronger link between our communities and our schools. We want our young students coming back to the school. So that's hopefully a benefit that can come out of something like this, or more of our students. We're already good, we know that. We have a really great school system. You know, maybe we could be even better and take on these challenges. And really, we have three common agreements about that. That, you know, our children have a right to the best education we give them, that every citizen should have a voice in the planning, that, you know, these are the things. Good things are already happening, but that there's challenges. And both, you know, the community should know more about both of those, right? And what happens in our schools affects our community. We own the schools, and by working together, we just get each other. So that was what all three schools did, right? In those meetings, and I knew you were part of them, it took us a while, lots of conversations, and everyone said, yeah, this is what we want to do. We can coordinate and maximize our potential.
Just three, four meetings for that group that agree on this.
It did. Yeah. So we had to really think about why would we want to do this. First, what is it, and why would we want to do it? So, we wanted to move on. Well, this was just an example.
Can you go back?
I was involved in part.
Can you go back one?
We've got Greendale, Greenfield, and Hill Point that's turned into communities.
We're going to straight one.
And we did it in two places.
We talked about it, and then it was like then Franklin, yeah, Franklin Oak Creek. Yeah.
Franklin is part of our school district.
There is a small segment.
Well, it's not actually as small as you think it is.
They're members.
As small as you think it is.
They're members. And we want to, we're not excluding them from participating. We're not,
particularly. We know Hills Corners and the Greenfield population are about the same, and whatever good spread is.
And geographically,
I don't mind. We'll take it back to that group.
None of these. This is all conversations happening. So, you know, we just strongly invite residents to participate.
Maybe the aldermen from that district.
Yeah. The community discussion drove a lot of it as well, because people see these three communities as tied together. Franklin probably not so much. I mean, even when I was in the 70s going to school here, it was, you didn't know where the line was between Greenfield and Greendale. I still sometimes don't remember where it is south of Greendale and the streets are Greenfield or the vice versa.
But Rick does have a point with Franklin addresses being part of our district, but we hadn't really
Absolutely. You can invite them there.
We'll put it this way, it would be a faux pas not to.
This is just an example of where I'm involved in the Montgomery, Alabama has injury challenge, baby challenge, and everything. Baby just processed, you know, and you know, personally, I facilitated over half of 7 times, and it was amazing. So that's what we did. The Kevin Beckins are important to some of the things we serve in our town. How do you get people to come to the table? They're busy, right? They won't always come to the table. But they won't always come. We don't have the leaders in the community like you, that say, we can hold a conversation, we're still working on this, almost the problem of social movement, and that'll go into our community in the next few. We gotta have people invited. And then the integrity, of the project will come, as long as we make sure all of our building advocates, including our students, and want everyone to get a chance to give us an input into what they want to do for our community, regardless of where we live, and what they want to ask us. We wanna make sure we reach out, and as you can see, a lot of folks do not have kids in the public spaces. So this is our chance to really engage people beyond, just the kids that are involved in our school. These are the questions that we ask, and, again, we start with what you want for our community, how we're different from one to another. And so if we can be even better as a community, what kind of schools do we need in order to keep or get the community beyond? And then, the key question on that is really this one. Because it creates a sense of shared vision and shared responsibility. Well, if this is what we want for our schools, and we want to do more of this, then what has to happen in our community to get the school we want? And I found that to be a very powerful question when we were in those rooms. Because that was always quiet, and it's very easy to say we want more parents involved, and we want more strategy. And then you walk away. That's not the question. And that would always come up, and then we'd have to ask people, so what has to happen in our community to get our parents involved? So you see where that, it's a challenging question. And I highly recommend, we haven't fought a few hours with the leadership team, but I'm pretty sure we're gonna have something similar to that. This is an example of the broad-based needs that we're going to come out of this conversation. This is what Alabama can help within Montgomery. And by the way, from where I got here, not in Montgomery, but in Alabama for about 15 years. And they have seen some great results by doing it this way. It's a little bit different because we connected the community in kind of a new way, and it's ongoing. So that's where this is a little bit different. And I like this graph here because you see it's simple. So we're going to keep it going once it gets started. Okay? So you start by analyzing, listening, coming up with agreement, action teams. It's very similar to what you're doing now, maybe just a little more broad space.
Luann, you stated Montgomery's had some success. Mm-hmm. Could you name just maybe one or two of them?
No, what? Montgomery, I gathered.
Okay, you want to do it at the end?
There's no time. And this is where it's all happening. Now, Montgomery, we just got to the point when I left there a year after that they had created a community center. So I don't have results from Montgomery, but I have results here. These are just a few. There's a lot more, including Oshkosh now, that just kicked it off this past January. But Birmingham, as you can see, they reached out to 2,000 people. You can go to these websites and see what they're doing, and there's results in every one of these communities. Here I thought it was interesting because Dothan, after 2 years of seeing results, with the community more involved, understanding the data, understanding what's happening in the group, and in Dothan, in Alabama, there's coming. The community went to the board and said, you know, this group, yes, we can, better funding group, receiving after they were looking for. And they got the school board to approve the funding increase. The community did. They went to the board and said, these are results, everyone is all in this together. Then they have to go to the state legislature and they have to go to the state. I don't want this to be a fundraising agency, but I'm telling you, people don't just come to you and ask for your advice unless they're completely engaged in their school and they want results, right? I mean, that is just, I've never seen that. Mobile is where it got started. Here's results. This was a property tax, again, a renewal at 87% in 2011. But what I like about that is the line where it says the people in the community value education and are willing to support what we're doing. And I think that's what we need for our schools. We need to be more supportive and people more engaged. The results that Mobile has gotten, you know, and didn't kind of go to the right constituents. They had some big things in mind on it. But like AYP back when we had that AYP, as the project, we went from 27 to 83 in 3 years. But they have high poverty and high results, and I'm just going to show you one school. This is, I think, your question for the big one, the boys to ask, you know, what are the results you can expect? This is a plot of Northfield neighborhood, although it's
conversations were things like, you know, business people were saying, well, what are the skills that they would like to see our students graduate with? What skills are they looking for in their businesses? Also, we were, you know, looking at this maybe as a way to build internship or kind of mentoring programs for our students.
Thank you.
conversations amongst these stakeholders? Do you give them questions, or do you lead the conversations, or?
I
home, right, to school. And basically, what we're seeing is we're seeing a need to be proactive. And at the middle school, we feel that it's the academics. After we get through the presentation, you're going to hear a lot of great things, but it's like, great. You got to come over to the school of experience and see some differences and changes that we're making. And we'll show you some data on that as well. But this is the thing, be respectful, be responsible, be safe. Every other Wednesday, on our early release days, you'll see every staff member, every actually employee in the middle school has a shirt that says this. And again, that's building that community. I heard a lot about that community tonight. This goes right along with it. You weren't going to wear them, but... and the picture on the top there, those are actually our students who made that WMS equals, again, respectful, responsible, safe. I think we have slides about that. We'll talk about that. This is a day after we work on that.
For that slide, I actually have to go on top of the real quick and the most important word for the title of the picture. But anyway, so this slide just talks about DPI. You know, PBIS isn't just Whitman Middle School. It's DPI, and DPI really means it. I guess the title is referring to PBIS is kind of that behavioral piece for the old pyramid of the behaviors, whereas the RPI is the academic piece. So DPI is strongly behind PBIS. It's in a lot of schools. I believe it's in Douglas and San Marino. This is our first year of middle school, first year in the school district doing PBIS. I think we're off to a really good start.
Is it mostly focused at middle school?
It is. I believe it's just at the middle school this year.
No, I mean, but just different districts?
Oh, no, there are some elementary schools and high schools as well. So it just talks about it actually to your point, that second sentence just kind of sums it up, that it's 1,000 schools. K-12, over 40 states, and I think a couple of the key pieces are a reduction in disciplinary intervention, so Mr. Boyle's involved in that. He's a lot less busy this year on some of those things. The increase in that academic achievement, I think, is going to come because once you see those behaviors improve, which we've been seeing, and once we have a consistent language for the students, I think the academic achievement is going to follow. And the data-based decision-making,
yeah.
was about teaching the staff as well, so that we're all doing the same thing.
And if you go along with that, you know, we do great staff, all of them, and some are very good at discipline. And it was getting them to understand that it's a community. So whatever is happening in your class is going to affect my class or Carol's class. So as Davey said, if we have consistent language, if we're all doing the same things, handling the same way, the kid knows. They don't have to guess now what happens in Mr. Carol's class, or what happens in mine. They know what exactly is going to happen. And it also, once we can educate this to the parents and the community, they're going to have an understanding to be clearer as to what the difference is. And that's something we're doing. Again, the goal, and it's really to intervene in our school, be proactive instead of kids screws up, now we're going to do something. We want to be able to continuously teach. I model this behavior. A big part of this is the teaching, and that's different. You know, it used to be just clear the rules. Know what they are. Well, you know, I'll give a prime example. In my class the other day, they teach a kid how to go sharpen his pencil and not distract the rest of the class. Seems simple, but the middle school kid who doesn't realize, oh my gosh, when I get up, I'm distracted. You know, those are skills that we now have to teach, and you know, maybe we always have, but we just kind of ignore them. The other piece is, this is not just, you know, sometimes it can look like a fluffy program where you're just kind of, you know, we have some great posters and things like this. Is all data driven. So we'll give you more specifics what that data looks like, how we're collecting the data, and that's something year one we're really trying to get better at. But this is all factual. This is not something that we're just kind of, you know, guessing on. It's subjective. And then as we move on, we'll start modifying. You know, where are the needs? What, and that's when we get in that tier two, which is coming in the future. I kind of talked about these, but these are the data collection pieces. These are our major categories this year. Behavioral acknowledgement slips, Mr. Carroll, I believe, is going to talk about those next. Those are daily things. The office referrals, those are big ones. So a kid is not responding to these little slips that we give them. Now it goes to an office referral that goes to Mr. Gordon, our dean. And he collects the data from there. And by the way, those slips, we collect that data. Attendance, you know, this goes into even a kid's attendance. So if we see a kid is having trouble with attendance, we're going to be proactive. We're going to figure out what can we do about it. What is the reason instead of part of the national area, we're moving on to. And the last one, same thing with parties. Coming up with the decision, Mr. Carroll is right now handing out what he's going to explain the next slide, I believe. Red and yellow, and I'll explain what that means, but those are the behavioral analysis slips. And again, you'll see the practical responsible states. Oh, Mr. Gallant, you took one, I'm sorry.
The acknowledgement form, this is meant to be a positive.
Well,
I wanted to ask though, but the other three were negative, right? Well, office referral, absentees, and then cardiac.
Good point. So the other data points that we're talking about, yeah, except for the behavioral acknowledgement slips, there's a positive and a negative. The office referrals, yeah, those are negative. Attendance. Could be a negative, could be a positive. We look at also rewarding those kids that have good attendance.
And the office referrals will help us determine what we need to really, okay, we need to go back and teach them, you know. But right now, we're finding classroom disruptions are our biggest concern. So this is one of the things we're going to have to, in our lessons, go back and teach, you know, what are the things that, what are the office referrals? Disruptions. Okay, is kids tapping the pencil, or is kids getting up and, you know, pull around or talking? So those, the data helps us determine, okay, this is where we have to focus on for reteach and reteach.
So when a student gets an office referral, do the parents get notified right away, or?
Yes, anytime a child meets with Mr. Gordon, they go to the office.
All right, so we have, this is our major collection, data collection. Positive slip would be the yellow one, the pink one, but we actually call it the red one, that would be the negative. So our goal here is basically, and you know, we're creating a customized data to work with the clients. I think that's what's important. A lot of time actually went into making these slips. So again, these are the tools to help identify the positive. As you can see, they're actually identical.
yellow being the positive, the red being the negative. So let's say a student comes into my class, and the student is prepared for class. He or she has their textbook, their assignments out, it's ready to go. That could be a positive yellow stick. And I will just simply hand that yellow positive stick to that student. Now that student's going to take that positive slip and utilize it to the local teacher. That same student could come into my classroom the next day, and maybe he or she is tardy, or maybe he or she does not have their textbook. So it's so we'll just simply give the student a red slip. And that could be Mrs. Richter. Maybe she's not ready for that. So Mrs. Richter, I'll just give this slip to her. And she knows. They do know about not showing gloves. They know. So she'll be responsible for filling it out. But now in that slip, you can see, again, this is the negative. On time, so it's party. That student would then give it back to us, and then that slip would stand into the office at the end of the day. So, can I add on to that? Again, I think the biggest part, the most powerful part of this is, at the end of the kid, it's their responsibility. They are taking ownership of their behavior, they acknowledge it, they know exactly what they did. And then the other key point of this is, as a teacher standpoint, I can be teaching. I can just keep on going and hand that kid the slip. I don't have to, the old system, stop, redirect this kid, and now I might have a conversation, I gotta stop my teaching, I lost my train of thought, whatever it is, the flow keeps going, and I can do my job as a teacher. So this has been a very powerful group.
It is very powerful, especially very important, but I see, and I hear a lot of people saying that the instruction doesn't stop. The teacher just, you know, simply goes over the desk, lays it down, it's not a big scene, the instruction continues. Another point I wanted to bring up was, now that it's the third quarter, a lot of the substitute teachers in the district that work in the building, they know what we're doing. They know whatever class you may teach in, they know we have the system in place. So this is a tool that they can use as well, and they can help us collect that data, especially for a sub that, you know, sometimes it's a challenge for a sub, for classroom facilitation, sometimes we can do that, you know how that works. So leaving those notes for those subs, you know, in fact, I did have a sub, and I told her about these slips, and she said, okay, we don't think about these them. Well, after our meeting, I saw her, and she's like, you didn't have to believe how powerful these little yellow slips are. And I'm like, well, what do you mean? What do you mean? Explain. Well, I started walking around with the yellow slips, and all the kids were just listening and paying attention. So that was really great to hear, because here we had a substitute teacher not complaining about any negative behaviors or threatening kids by, you know, walking around with these red slips. Instead, she was walking around with yellow. And I thought that was very powerful. And as a sub, she really enjoyed having that power and having that control of the classroom.
And I haven't seen our data recently, but I believe our numbers are that our positive, you know, slips are outweighing our negative slips that are handed out to the students, like 4-1 or something like that. So, you know, by that positive reinforcement, you're also making a message.
So, then how many of these slips do you give out in a day?
Are you asking me?
Well, or anyone. You answer.
Sure.
I
don't
know. I would have to say, though, that for the kids, you give them the power. Truly, back into them, because they are making positive choices.
I mean, do you give a few out in a classroom, or do you give everybody in the classroom a pink or a yellow slip, or?
A big thing is, and also Ms. David talked about, you know, when we see the data, we see classroom disruption, this time is a big part. So this is how the positive observation comes in. We're going to acknowledge now those kids that are not being, you know, distractible or distracted or whatever. We're going to hit them on a positive instead of the old school system of, all right, I'm just going to look now for that kid that's distracted. And it's amazing, twisting around the positive. Now these kids are role models, they see it, and these kids are visual. So they see that just a little simple piece of yellow paper, and it's amazing how their behavior shifts. And they want to kind of shape up real quickly.
Any other questions about our questions?
interest level. And this is something that we had piloted last year, knowing that we were going to move it towards PBIS this year. And what the voice bubbles allowed us to do was have this in all of our classrooms and in the common areas in our school. And it is a reminder to all students what your voice level needs to be in that area. And some areas are noted as to, okay, in this area, you know, the one or two, and we'll also tell you how we taught the students that. But it's also a really helpful tool for, as a teacher, you can say, okay, we're at a zero, okay? And even by just holding up your hand, the students know that it's absolutely silent and no one is talking, okay? This is very powerful when our entire school comes together for an assembly. And Mrs. Davies, I clearly remember here at the auditorium, she's standing on the stage. We have our entire school, middle school, 6th and 8th graders, and she was within a couple of seconds by just saying that it's a zero, and other teachers, you know, also showing that visual that we were all quiet. Did not take us very long. This is something that the kids really caught on to quickly. Again, this is something that when we have subs or any other visitors in our school, they're allowed and they're able to use this tool as well. This is also something that has carried over outside of the school day. And, you know, for instance, if we're on a field trip, okay, it needs everyone's attention. This is something that we can be using. The students understand it. You know, we had to teach them at what level, what does it mean. We also modeled to them, and we actually did a little role playing. Okay, what does it mean to be at a one? You're whispering. Only one other kid can hear you, or one other person can hear you. And so once we went through and we taught this to them, it was universally something that we could be using throughout our school. So you will see this in every classroom, and you will see it throughout the hallways as well.
So PBIS is a lot more than just the signs that we have up in the hallways and in the classrooms and the voice levels and the things like that. Honestly, when I think about our group and our staff and our administration, what we've done this year is after I looked at this PowerPoint, I mean, it was pretty powerful. We're only here in March. Some of the things that we've done to support PBIS and to have kids, you know, change their behaviors more towards the positive. You know, not that they haven't been there before, but maybe to take it to the next step. So one of the other things that we do, you're going to see some of the activities in a few slides, but I just want to talk about some of the almost like guidance lessons, because some of the character education is the things that I've been doing in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, but this is just even giving it more emphasis. And I know the teachers have done a wonderful job getting behind this. We have a theme, and you can see the slide up there that the theme supports are responsible, respectful, and safe. You know, a small example I can remember in October, for respectful, we had a unit on bullying. And we showed like a little YouTube clip, and it had this boy with really bright red hair walking down the sidewalk, and a couple of kids made fun of him and made the kid feel pretty small. And there was a bunch of kids on kind of on the sidelines just watching it. And then the next part of the clip showed like the next day or whatever, and the boy walking down the sidewalk with bright red hair, a couple of kids come over and make fun of him. Now these kids on the sideline all had red hair. They had painted they had dyed their hair red, and they were the bystanders. And it kind of, you know, made a message. And, you know, you could just see the kids getting engaged with the video, and then the teachers just kind of spurring on that conversation with the kids. And it's really powerful. We do it a couple times a month with the early release days, and it's just kind of built into the schedule this year. You know, there's been a lot of other units, trustworthiness, self-motivation, kindness, honesty, and fairness. And I want to show the next slide, too, that kind of just speaks to the lessons. Again, one more small example. So this is a teacher, I think he's in our room right now, Mr. Shapiro, that decided that for the kindness unit, that he's going to have this whiteboard up there, and to get the kids engaged, get the kids started on the conversation for the 46 minutes of that class period, you know, Susie, what does kindness mean to you? You know, and et cetera, et cetera. So they all put it on there, and then you can, you know, get some dialogue going from there. I think it just kind of not only carries in that class period, I think it carries throughout the day, and, you know, it has some staying power beyond that.
It does have some staying power, and I can speak to that. I never would have thought a $20 whiteboard is so valuable, but it, I mean, to have these kids have the opportunity to write down their thoughts about a lesson that they just had, not only do they get to voice their emotions and their feelings, but they get to see everybody else's thoughts. And that's very powerful. I really appreciate that.
So our first day kickoff is from Jody. All the staff, custodians,
everyone
received a shirt. And so it was our thought last year when we went to the training as a group that we were going to have a first day kickoff like you have for opening day. It was the opening day of school, and we wanted to be excited about it, and we wanted the kids to be excited, and we were all on the same team. And so we set up different stations to teach some of the ways that you could be respectful, responsible, and safe in different situations, in the cafeteria. This is
our routine bus here.
So we drew, somebody drew the bus, and we loaded the bus, and it was a little competition. Loaded the bus, see who could say, you know, good morning, and then they got up and said, you know, have a good day, and all of that, because a lot of times there have been in the past bus issues, and I'm not saying that they've been eliminated or anything, but if you have the kids understand that, you know, this is, and a lot of that stemmed, and I'm sure many of you saw that over the summer, the lady who's a monitor on the bus, she was an older woman, and how the kids really, you know, were not very nice to her. And so, you know, obviously, we need to then engage and have some teaching on that. And rules. Okay, at the nature pod, and how do you, I mean, when you're out of the school setting, how, if we're having conversation, how then do we need to, you know, behave regardless of where you are? Regardless if you're in school or out of school or somewhere else on a field trip. So all of that was our first day kickoff, and from time to time we revisit with the kids.
How do you behave in the hallway, in the gym? You know, maybe you're at an athletic event. Is that different than when you're at a presentation? How about how do you behave when you use the restroom? So it was every area of the school you can imagine. They rotated through and learned about the expectations.
And then I brought a picture of the bus, which wasn't there, but it was our hopes that we would have an actual bus driver, an actual bus.
We tried, they wouldn't.
And again, student and visual people to physically have them get on the bus. And that's, again, moving forward, we want to expand this. We want more community involvement in this. We want the bus drivers there. We want anybody that's associated with the school as part of this on this day, and so that they see them in a different way. For example, the custodians of Northam, having the custodian giving them an authority rule, a role in this whole thing, instead of just a student seeing them as a custodian and not even knowing their name. They're part of their school. The kids need to know who that individual is.
Into the gym together. Some of them had dances. It was a lot of fun to be able to bring everyone together and to talk to them. And so we've had some home-based activities to continue throughout the year, and we're hoping that next year throughout the school, 6th and 8th grade, that we can be doing something like this.
That feeling, that sense of being part of the community, and how to be seen as inmates, and how to be seen as part of that community. Getting back to our devil slips, we have what we call our Falcon Superstore. And the Falcon Superstore is a store.
for that students can go to every morning in the cafeteria, Tuesdays and Thursdays. And as you can see here, here are all the slips, and they're signed by the teachers, and the reasons why they receive those slips. And so now is the time where students can get reimbursement for those incentives for being rewarded for doing good. We have a window cabinet here, a little bit of window shopping. Kids can purchase anything from a vitamin water to a pack of gum to a backpack to a bag of chips, you know, candy and other fun items and pencils. We've reduced the prices for the food.
And the key is inexpensive thing. These are very, but for the kids,
and as you can see, it's run by the kids. They organize it. They stock up this cart here that our janitor, Mr. Jay Dombrowski, put together for us. And it made it look really nice. Again, gives the kids a sense of empowerment. And when kids, you know, turn in those tickets and they buy them from other kids, it's just a real nice thing.
The kids also do the inventory on the store for us. And so Jen and I today at the school, they came to me last week, Thursday, and said, Mom, this is kind of like our school done in the little role on Tuesday. Here's the list. So, you know. So there you are, you know, very responsible and.
One of the other things that Sandy and I have taken on every Friday is we have raffles, and the students are able to participate in the raffles if they have turned in their yellow slips. So the yellow slips that are used at the Falcon Superstore are also placed in this raffle, or students can decide they don't want to purchase something from the store. We have a basket in the office that they place their yellow slips in. And literally on Friday, we'll do an 8th hour. Mm-hmm. There are students running in between the 4 minutes, you know, from 7th hour to 8th hour. Did they tell you that? Who would have got more? So, you know, it's quite comical on Friday afternoons. But so we're able to pick students from 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. We take time to announce their names over the loudspeaker, recognize them for being consistently respectful, responsible, and safe. Students are able to come down and choose an item. And then something else that we've also, we don't do every Friday, but sporadically we will do attendance notebook checks. Something that's responsible and instilling that responsibility and organization in the students. So we will call a handful of names. Please bring your attendance notebooks down to the office. And we have a line of raffle and a line of attendance notebooks. They have to open up their planners for the week and show us that, you know, even if you didn't have homework,
written in.
Yeah, you wrote in it, you acknowledged that you went to that class, maybe what you did in class, or maybe also, you know, we said even just writing in no homework, at least you acknowledge that you look at it. And so I would say more often than not, we have students that have completed it, and some of them will come down and they're like, I didn't even write it down because I knew it wasn't done. I'll try again for next week. So we have really positive things for us to do. This is good.
October. October 1st, we had, obviously, we encouraged all the kids to wear blue that day. Boston Store sells actually these blue shirts, and the left staff members went up and purchased those for them. So it was World Day of Bullying Prevention. And we focus on that and what it looks like. And I've got this nerd. And so, who was it, Jim, that you said about the lesson with the red hair? That was the PBI lesson for that day, the young man who was being bullied because of the color of his hair. And he had no control over that whatsoever. And our kids, we had, as Brian said, we've had great conversations in our rooms and have taken them back, you know, to our meetings and to other staff members and things like that. And kids have been very involved and engaged in from this anti-bullying day shirt. Some kids in my 6th grade wanted to do something extra about it. And so they, myself and
General Larson, on Tuesdays, we have a little anti-bully club, so to speak, during our lunchtime, during their lunchtime, and seventh grade has something during that time, so I'll let some of their seventh graders come home for just a little bit of time. Yeah, and they, and so they've had lots of good conversations about that and what it looks like and what it feels like and how it's not, you know, very respectful thing to be doing to one another. And so it's been a very positive experience, I do believe, for all involved.
And you may or may not be aware, just one more thing that we've been doing, and this, we've been doing this actually since 2006, is our Student of the Month program. And basically this gives us teachers and even aides in the building the opportunity to really recognize those students who have gone above and beyond. Maybe it's students that have done some volunteer work in the school, or maybe they've had other, done other things with the building that maybe other kids don't know about. So teachers or teams of teachers have the opportunity to recognize them. And here's one student in particular who just received a Student of the Month certificate. So we basically, we take her picture. Oh, you can pass that down. Good. I like what you're doing. And we give them a Student of the Month t-shirt. So that recognition is, it's nice for the kids. And these posters are hung up in the cafeteria. So basically for the public to see. And the students that come in, they get to read why these students who are, you know, the best of the best, need that recognition. They get to see their peers in the limelight.
In January, we had a courage retreat for the seventh grade. We worked with a company called Youth Frontiers, and they brought in facilitators that worked with kids, helped them kind of do team building and help them understand how they can make changes in the world, be courageous to make changes. And it was a phenomenal day. It was high energy. The kids loved it. The feedback from the kids was incredibly positive. And this is going to become an annual event. It was just wonderful. So,
Hey Lynn, before you talk about the data, can I ask our students what they think of this and if this would have been helpful for them when they were in middle school?
As a student, a past student of Wyndham Middle School, I think this is a really good opportunity. I myself was a student of the month, so I think it was a good program. And I think from the information that we've been given so far, I think the program is going, it's been very successful, and I think that it being continued on will bring big change to the middle school and will be very helpful for the participants. So I'm very impressed with the program.
I agree with Allison. I did not go to Wyndham Middle School, but I think it's something that would have really been helpful at my school, and it looks like awesome things are happening for the kids and it's working, so.
And I have a quick question too. Were the parents given like a little presentation like you're doing for us?
Not a presentation. It's something we probably should do, and we did send some information about it. You know, your kid's going to come home after the first day and talk about this and student engagement. But you know what? It's probably not a bad idea. When we do our transition meeting with the parents, and gosh, it's going to come up soon, next month, it will be part of our conversation with our incoming sixth grade parents. So, you know, our students really are becoming very respectful, responsible, safe young men and women. You know, remember in the beginning when I said that we were shooting for a 10% reduction in our major infractions. Now this is, the data is from the first day of school to last Friday, and I used the same dates from the previous year, so already we're seeing great, great results. If you look at the green, that's this year, the pink is last year. So, you know, we still have kids who need some help. We need some reteaching and help making better decisions. But for the most part, when you look at things like harassment, we're way down in kids being involved in harassment or insubordination. physical aggression, fighting, things like, well, fighting is it, but physical aggression, pushing each other around, and that sort of thing, you know, book, getting kids book action, and book, all that kind of thing is down. So we are really, we're beyond our goal so far this year. And I think if we can make it through third quarter without many more infractions, we're going to be golden. Third quarter is when everything kind of goes crazy. You're ready for spring break, teachers are ready for spring break, and our suspension rate seems to go up during third quarter. I think if we make it through these next couple weeks, we're going to look really good with our data. How this translates to suspensions, we are at about 50% less suspensions than we had this time last year. And we have, for repeat offenders, those kids who just, you know, can't seem to get it right. I think last year this time we had, nine kids maybe who were habitually offending compared to two. So kids are, if they're getting in trouble, they're learning and making other improvements. So we would argue that there's our suspension. So we're about down about 50%. And how does this translate to student learning? Our students are doing well. This is our math data you will remember from the elementary. It's kind of the same chart with our students for math, but we're doing well. Our kids are performing and above what our expected growth is in all three grades from fall to winter. We're doing really well. But I think the thing you can't quantify, we're doing very targeted teaching interventions. And these are, I just picked, these are some of the kids who have been involved in some sort of intervention during targeted teaching. And if you look at the growth in those kids, their RIT scores, some of these kids are just making outstanding growth just because of those interventions. And the thing that I don't think we can quantify here, and the teachers will all speak to this, is that kids aren't afraid to ask for help. They're becoming more confident in the classroom to raise their hand and participate, to ask questions. They don't see it as necessarily a stigma that they're in an intervention group, that this is my opportunity to get some help. And so I think PBIS has really helped that we all are at different rates, and it's okay, and we're going to do what we need to do to help you be successful. So that's some of our successes on our math score. Conversely, in reading, you know, and similarly, we're doing well. Our sixth grade group came to us a little low in the beginning. If you look at that yellow highlight, they were down about 1.7 points in the difference between the norm group and how our kids actually did. But by the end of the winter, they've grown 2.5 points beyond what the expected grade growth is. Eighth grade, you know, I don't know what happened. They're doing well, but they're one tenth of a point below. Statistically, I don't think that they're going to really go there better. But our kids continue to demonstrate growth. They're growing more than expected based on the norms. So we're doing well. Same thing, you know, I can show you some success stories of kids involved in interventions. And they're excelling. Our score results this year, we continue to consistently score above the national average in all of our subject areas. So, you know, that's a pretty good indicator that our kids are on track to be ready for college and career readiness. So where do we go from here?
Well, I mentioned in the beginning that one of the first slides is tier one, 80-90% of our student population in that category. And a lot of teachers will come to us and say, okay, this is great, but you know what, I got the same kids acting up over and over. You know, there's two or three kids in every grade level. And that's where we're heading next. That is the ultimate goal. Tier two is what we want to start now looking at. So one thing that we're going to pilot this fourth quarter is each grade level has been asked to pick one student that they feel would benefit from a system called the check-in, check-out. We're talking about a kid that not necessarily maybe is horribly behaved, but maybe somebody that just, they feel like is not fitting in, and that's affecting them socially and academically. And the system basically would be where we have an individual, not a teacher, would not have the flexibility in the morning and the consistency, because the mornings are not ever consistent. We don't know what's going to happen. But a teacher that would be there, or an aide, in this case, would check in with a student, and a check-in would be something like this, you know, okay, good morning, John. Maybe nobody said good morning to this kid. Maybe roll out of bed, you need to have breakfast, and now we're expecting to go to field for class and learn. Doesn't work that way. So now this kid's going to have somebody, and they're going to build a relationship, which is what this whole program you've kind of seen is all about. They get a relationship with that kid. Now that kid's feeling comfortable, you know, telling this individual, you know, I'm struggling here. And now we can start figuring out what do we do for this kid. End of the day, same system, except for now it's, okay, how did they go? You have everything you need. You have your assignments. Are you organized? You're ready to go. A lot of kids need, especially middle school, they need a system like this that's consistency, because that's what they're lacking in their life. They don't have that consistency. So this is where we're gonna pilot this fourth quarter, and we're gonna track the data. We're gonna look at where is this kid academically, socially, and then we're gonna look at the end of the fourth quarter, did this help them? If we wanna move forward with this, if we wanna make this a program that is school wide and we start integrating more and more kids that fit in that tier two category. So that's what we're gonna.
And this, is that student to student, or parent to student, or teacher to parent?
This would be, and you mentioned parent, this would be, and you made a good point, again, bringing back the community. Moving forward, that's really what we want to look at, is bring the community in. This, what I was speaking about was either a teacher or an aide, basically a school employee, that would be there on a consistent basis at 7:50, would meet that child, and get them ready for the day. And at the end of the day, 3:05, meets that kid. But, you know, once you get to, you know, 15-20%, a high number of students, you break it down, so we're going to need some outside help. And that's where, you know, if this program's successful moving forward, that's what we're going to look at. Is, you know, who can we bring in? We're going to have to think outside the box on this, because we don't have enough staff members that have that consistency built in our data. So.
Yeah,
really want to thank you for listening. I know this went really long, but you know what? I hate to kind of move along because they're really proud of the work they've done, and I cannot take any of the credit other than being the one to support them through this all. They have taken this as their baby and have run with it, and you know, our school is becoming a better place because of their leadership. So thanks for your patience and allowing us to take up so much time.
And thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Awesome. So Stephanie has some questions, so.
Come on, guys, you didn't think I'd fill a chat out here that easily.
Yes.
Mr. Carroll handed me a pink slip. If you didn't think I wasn't going to try to fix that. Yeah, okay. So here's what I'm looking at, though. I'm looking at our eighth grade. This was the pilot year, but this is also their last year. So they've only had 1 year under this system. So my question to this group, and also Mrs. Winter, are you still back? Okay, just checking, thanks. Because culture makes the difference. I talked about this a couple years ago with Mr. Rozowski, how impressed I was. I walked in the building, someone held a door open for me and directed me to the office. So it matters. But where this eighth grade is kind of like the pilot class of the pilot program, can we build into the system some longitudinal data to see how that eighth grade behaves when they're freshmen? And so forth, that by the time that the current sixth grade class hits the doors as a freshman across the street, how is that going to influence their life in high school? And are they able to take those lessons that have obviously been so clearly laid out for them and apply them into a bigger setting, if you will, and keep reinforcing that? And can we start that now to do some of that longitudinal data to see how it affects their future? So that was the first one. The second one is that with Mr. Siebert's help, I was able to compliment a student. I was in the building looking for my daughter, and I had a student that said, you know, can I help you? Is there someone that you need to see? Can I help you? And she was just at her locker finishing up for the day. There was nobody else around, and she just wanted to know if I needed some help. So I was able to grab Mr. Siebert in the hall and give her a yellow slip for that. So not only encouraging your substitutes, but encouraging other people that have business in the building to reinforce that system, and like Leanne said earlier, bringing that community in so that the kids demonstrate that it's not just within the confines of the building, that others have these expectations too once they're out of their little bubble. And then the other...
Just to interject there, I thought that girl was very impressed to find out you were a board member.
She's only one of the one, let me tell you.
It was so crowded at it.
And then how does this change engagement? If we're reaching out to some of, I hate to call them disenfranchised, but some of those that might be out on the outer rim in middle school where this is such a huge age for adjustment, how, is there a way that we can track their engagement above and beyond the attendance? Now that's a critical part, but we talk about engagement at the high school. Are they participating in dramatics? Are they participating in sports? Are they participating in music? Is there a way that that's another data collection point that we can start taking a look at so that we can measure somehow that the students feel that they're part of the, part of the team in when they're just with their peers and after school activities, that this is filtering on down to even those types of activities? That's my list.
I would say for the last one, yes. At the end of the year, we're going to administer a student climate survey, and some of those kinds of questions will be asked, and you know, we'll be able to report back on the perception of the students. Your questions about, you know, will this carry over to the high school? What I can tell you from the trainings we've been through and conversations with other schools that have PBIS in place, that this does transfer up. It just becomes part of how they do business. So other districts have, a lot of districts start in the middle school because middle school is the perfect time. You know, kids are, you know, it's a crazy time in the lives of kids. And so middle school usually starts, and a lot of times the high school continues what we've already built upon. But from what we found out from others is that, you know, what we're teaching them, those are life skills. You know, we're teaching them how to work in the real world. I believe they'll continue to roll on up. Now, eighth grade, you know, they are our first eighth grade kind of going through it. If I had to quantify, you know, which students are more engaged, eighth grade's probably less engaged than seventh grade, but not completely disengaged either. You know, they haven't had the opportunity to really live this like the first grade.
And on top of that, we are going to tutor. I mean, this is not something that is, you know, how it's taught in sixth grade, it's taught in eighth grade, it's no different than math. How we teach in seventh grade is no different than it's taught in sixth grade. So it's modifying, it's tiering it, which can easily be adjusted to the high school. I mean, you go online, you type in PBS, and then you're going to hit thousands, if not millions of links, high schools, elementary schools, that again, building economic measures, that system to be a community throughout the school.
Through implementing this, have we found areas that we need to improve?
Yeah.
Like?
Our biggest area of concern right now is classroom disruption. You know, those unsupervised areas that you think the kids are getting into trouble, hallway, the cafeteria, not so much. It's, you know, how do you keep adolescents who, you know, have a hard time focusing some days anyways, focus on what they're doing and, you know, being able to get up and not disrupt the whole class when they go to start with their pencil. It's those things. Are they major? No, but that's our biggest story.
And a lot of that is data collection. We've been tweaking this all year. How, what is the best, most efficient way? We got basically one of our faculty members who is volunteer every time in the morning to help these things. You know, is that the most efficient goal? So we're trying to use it to the campus, how can we track this better? As well as what data, getting more specific data, what time of day is this happening, where is it happening? So that now we're very specific now, we can look at that, you know, maybe from 11 to 1, that's where our biggest issues are. And we can sort of identify a specific problem and address it. Instead of just a bang, you know, we get classroom disruption. But when, you know, there's probably a reason why it is from 11 to 1. And we're hungry.
When we talk about addressing it, that is something that we do like to think about before. And that's when we will create and customize and modify the systems that are and teach to that
level. And going on to, you know, experiments, again, the 8th grade, we're looking at the future. Now the 7th grade was established, a good group this year. Well, on 8th grade, we're looking at those leaders. So now carry this, now we're hoping they're going to start creating videos where they can teach these lessons, getting, tapping into their creativity, their experience with this, their knowledge, and at the same time, their interest level. You know, they're not at that point as interested in sitting down and talking about this and listening. They want to create. And even if they're creating, they're still learning in the same school that really good at
that. To piggyback on that, I'm not doing that. But the students feel empowered. They feel empowered, I think, because, you know, they feel comfortable, they feel safe, they don't worry about what other kids are thinking about them. And like you were saying before about this intervention, they're more open-minded to getting that, or raising their hand,
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Excellent presentation. All right, so now we'll move on to 3D, budget, RFP, and OPEB updates.
Okay, for those of you who aren't aware, Doug is a victim of that flooding that's, with all the snow melt, and he was downhill, and so he was trying to trench water away from his house. He's not feeling quite up to being here tonight. So there's someone in our district who also is a certified business manager who Doug works with once in a while, is listed on there, who's done a lot of different things in our district in the last year. But Joel said he would, he talked to Doug, and if there's any questions on what's presented in the board packet, he'd do his best to try to field those questions. This is, like Doug said, it's just for information only. He's kind of giving an update on the budget, where we are, and when we hope to have it out. And so it's the questions are up to you, and Joel start to try to field them, and if he has any issues, he'll just say, wait till Doug gets here. All right.
Does anyone have any questions?
I think because they're for information, there isn't a lot of questions as we go through, and we're working on budget, or we're working on whether it be the insurance or whatever, but it's just the background information.
Well, in regards to the insurance consultation, I trust that we have competent people that can compare, or try and compare these, because
it's a very interesting situation, because it's a very
I couldn't agree more that the low bid isn't always the best bid.
And that grid will go through the finance committee, I would assume, initially. And
all right, thanks, Joel. That wasn't too hard. Well, in my world, that falls under HR anyway, so.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll move on to the high school representative report. I know we had an Allison because I heard someone mention your name. So could you introduce yourself and what grade that you're in, and then the gentleman can introduce himself.
My name is Allison Lemahue, and I am a junior here at Whitnall.
My name is Jess Higgins, and I am a senior here.
Okay. So what do you have to tell us about the high school? What's going on?
We are both representatives on the Student Senate, which, you know, it's a very busy organization here at Whitnall. In the past month, we've had two huge events. We've had the Winter Cornhole Dance, and we've had our Spring Blood Drive. So I'll let Jess talk to you guys about the Winter Cornhole Dance.
Well, the dance is not as interesting as the blood drive, but we were able to raise... I know you guys are probably all interested in how our dance went. Attendance was at an all-time high. It set a record for the school, and we were able to raise a lot of money that we'll use for future projects and charities in the school.
What do you attribute that to?
Just getting it out there more, I think. And this year we had a great committee on Senate for all the chairs and things that we did for that. And we made it had never been a Sadie Hawkins before, but we changed that.
Okay.
I don't know if that was it. Some girls just wanted to get asked and didn't go in the other way. So.
I was on the publicity, I was one of the publicity chairs for that event, and we kind of came up with the catchphrase, and we were talking at one of our meetings, and our president, Connor Tui, was talking, and everyone kind of went to Cornwall, which has this, like, homecoming was like, oh, I'll be up for the whole time, but Winterfell was like, yeah, I don't know, and then, so Connor was talking about how everyone kind of has this perception that it's going to be, like, weird, and we're like, he's like, guys, we had a promo, it's going to be fun, not weird this year. And so we, myself and the other chair thought that was kind of catchy and thought people would, that would get people's attention. So when we made announcements, we used that, and every day I'd have people coming up to me, like, saying that, and I think we really publicized it a lot this year, and I feel like that helped a lot. So it was really impressive. So I was really excited with how many people came. For the blood drive, the theme, we went to the theme. This time was Finding Nemo. And so we had a catchphrase and everything. We have little buttons that we make. And the theme was Just Keep Donating. And the slogan was Just Keep Donating. We had a lot of people sign up. Not as many people, more people sign up for the fall one generally, because of track season coming up. We always have a little bit of issue with that, but we still had, I believe, 108 people sign up this year, which is including seniors, anyone over 16 can donate, and it was very successful. So it was the first one in a few years that no one passed out at, so that was a success. Because last time we had quite a few people, so we were really cautious about that, and we didn't have any issues this time, so that was good. We had a lot of people donate. Every time someone donates, we save three lives with a whole blood. So we had a lot of lives. We had over, I think we had like 90 people that were able to donate, and it was a huge success, so I was very excited about that. And I don't know, it's just, I feel like whenever the blood drive happens, everyone's just excited, and just
big event.
It's a really fun. I win the school and is excited about it. And coming up for us is the weekend of, the first weekend of May, we have our Senate State competition where we all get together with a bunch of other schools in the WASC, which is the Wisconsin Association of Student Councils. And we all get together at a hotel in Green Bay, and we do workshops and bonding experiences, and and we all have activities. Like last year, I had to give a multimedia presentation, and so now we'll be preparing for that. We have to start assigning people to certain tasks, and then the week after that, we also have to start preparing for elections for next year, for who's going to manage that board, and getting prepared for next year, because as we've noticed the past few years, we want to get prepared for, like, next fall sooner to be prepared, because this past year we didn't have as many freshmen participate originally as we anticipated. So more of it was put on the upperclassmen, which can be kind of troublesome for getting ready for the future. So this year we've been focusing a lot on trying to get ready for next year and making next year successful. So I think that's really it. Yeah.
All right, thank you. And thanks for coming tonight. All right, and F on the agenda, policy 723 revisions.
Bernie knew he wasn't going to be able to be here, but he wanted to at least have them out in front of the board for an opportunity for you to review them for the first revision, and suggest that if you have any questions or suggestions, you can A, either give them to us here and now, or B, email them to Matt Carson and myself. And Matt's taken on the lion's share of taking those suggestions and putting them down in writing.
I guess my question was, we had struck
language out of the emergency plan segment that struck the part that said district emergency handbooks will also be available in all administrative offices. I'm just a little curious as to why we'd want to take them out of a building if that's our reference manual, as it were, and why we wouldn't want to have them in each office.
Well, each building principal, of course, would have one, because
but each building principal will have.
Well, in a past correspondence at the administrative meetings, there were, I don't know what buildings they were, but there were, as of November 8th or so, there were a couple of schools that hadn't submitted their crisis plan as of that date.
Their updates.
Oh, yeah, we have updates. Yeah. A lot of updates.
Is it possible to have that information prior to school starting? Just so that crisis plan is.
As far as the special ed stuff, we have some things that are specific.
Okay.
But is it possible? Yeah, I think we need to come to the point of that crisis plan.
Because if we have a crisis plan to go to and it's not completely filled out and it's something happens in September and it doesn't do us any good.
Right, I think what happened. This year specifically, I just want to take another role in that theater, and I think in the future, now that I have a little worksheet of what we need to update, that we really need to have a $30 in my education. So, I think that's
well, I would like to see that it's updated in prior to school starting.
Sure, I agree.
The other thing is, the two elementary school, this is to do with the fire drills. The two elementary schools, when we asked for information as to how many were they up to date with their fire drills, they gave us a spreadsheet that was very nice and clean and neat as to the time, the date, what station it was pulled at. I'd like to see that being uniform for all four of our schools. Use that. I'm sure that Chris or Lori have it.
Yeah.
Pardon? No, I think they created it themselves.
They just happened to use the common one, whereas the question was just put out how many and when.
Right.
Some of them used the form, some of them just replied because it was just the information that was requested.
The one that they gave us was real neat, clean, and the information was right there and all, very detailed.
Can I have one question? On the, when we're talking about the lockdown drills, that it would be at least once within the first 30 days of each school semester, is that new wording or has that been in there?
That's new wording.
That is new wording, okay, because I knew we had talked about that.
Commend Matt's wife for putting up with the board meeting on their anniversary.
Happy anniversary.
Better make it a 15.
I told her that he would take her to an even nicer restaurant because he was here.
All right, thanks, Matt. Thank you, Matt. Okay, old business, number 4A, discuss and take possible action on resignation agreement.
there a motion to approve that?
Would you approve the agreement as presented?
Thank you, Rick. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Stephanie. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Aye.
And for, so that would be 4-1. Okay. And then 4B, discuss and take possible action on retirement negotiations.
I guess someone could make a motion.
Make a motion to hold it, or we can just hold it. Well, no motions, we'll hold that over. All right, then, number 5, comments from the school board regarding agenda items for future consideration.
I have one. How the district handled the communication in regards to our ex-food service director?
Okay, anyone else?
Just kind of, I guess what I would like to see is Lowell and I kind of talked about this, but just a report or just some kind of acknowledgement to the district that we do have a process in which contracted employees that we do background checks. I think that was an important factor that needs to be brought out in the communications.
Verifying that they were done.
That they were in fact done, and that we do them, and that it would not just be the food service, but with the janitorial services.
And how often do they recheck them during their employment history?
I guess bus drivers would also be somebody who should be included.
Okay, anything else? Right, number 6, board member announcements.
I have one. March 23rd, there's a community event for the Allison Dudek Ice Rink that will be taking place at Finn McGuire's. Again, that's March 23rd.
This weekend is the Rotary Club Craft Fair. And then also Godspell is February 21st, 22nd, and 23rd. And Wednesday, March 20th, is actually the senior citizen dinner and musical.
What is that? I don't even know.
Wednesday, the senior citizen dinner is Wednesday, March 20th.
And if you have...
Okay, what time?
I think 4:30.
Oh, I thought I was just coming for dinner.
No, you're working.
So we're playing meat.
We serve. The board serves. So if you haven't responded to Kathy yet, please do.
And then I also just wanted to mention that I had an opportunity to attend a Wisconsin School Public Relations Association Community Engagement Workshop in Whitewater on Friday with Wendy. And just kind of the whole, the process of how to work within the community to kind of gather input and ideas that we could later incorporate into our educational process. And Leanne kind of learned two really cool techniques I'm going to share regarding, revolving conversation or something called World Cafe, where you put out sheets and everybody writes their ideas of what they want, and then you rotate tables so everybody shares the world experience. So just wanted to let people know that was something that I did attend, and I think the skills that I heard there or things that we've kind of learned to what we're currently working on.
Okay. Then, lastly, motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
And all in favor, please say aye.
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 Kathy, will you...